Welcome, my friends. You're listening to the Voice of the Eternal Gospel, a program brought to you by the Eternal Gospel Ministry. Founded in 1992 by Seventh-day Adventist believers, this is a Christian program dedicated to bring you the prophetic fulfillment, warning, and revelations of the end times, and to promote the advancement of Christ in your life.
Welcome again, my friends, to the Voice of the Eternal Gospel. I'm Pastor Rafael Perez, and I'm inviting you to pray with us. Let's pray.
Father in heaven, it's with grateful hearts we again come into thy divine presence. We ask for the presence of your Holy Spirit, that he will abide with us, that we can rightly divide the word of truth. You said, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Lord, we ask that your Spirit will guide us now and help us to understand the book of Revelation, chapter 14, and grant that it be a blessing. You pronounced a blessing on the whole book of Revelation.
Yes.
And we ask that this understanding of this blessing will be understood. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Well, let me mention quickly, in previous program, we have been talking about reading some of the definition or characteristic of this 144,000. And we have seen so far that they're going to be living in a time very similar than Elijah of the Old Testament, of the Elijah of the New Testament, who was John the Baptist. And we are living in a time. I hope that you have been following these presentations to the very letter, because we are indeed living in a time when God is seeking, is looking to for those, what we call the third Elijah this time. For those of you who have been missing the program, you know you can go to eternalgospel.com. You can click in there where it says TV programs. Or those of you who want to hear the national radio program that we have, you can go and listen at your spare time also, those programs, by clicking radio program. Okay? So it's very important. You also will find in our website literature, like this one that we have, the Antichrist Identify, the system. For many people, this is a mystery. Just because the Bible, my friends, is speaking symbols, that doesn't mean that God doesn't want us to understand it. No. God has been giving, especially those two books, in symbols, because he knew that if it wouldn't be in symbol, maybe they would have tried to destroy the Bible completely. Isn't that true? Would you agree with me?
And the enemies of those who hate the Bible.
Yes. That's right. That's right. So this booklet, free of charge, we've been sending to thousands of you out there. I know thousands of you and thousands, priests, evangelicals, minister, has been getting copies of this, and the laity too. Another book that we want to remind you also is a book, America, the Papacy, and the Signs of the Times. It's a good book. And by the way, all these books, I'm glad to report that many of, quite a few of those of you who have been watching this program or listening to the radio have been calling our office and placing order by boxes. Yes, we will provide boxes of those material to those of you who wants to get involved into, you know, giving out these books before it's going to be too late. Because remember, we've been studying that one of the issues that we're going to be facing very soon is the union of church and state, where the woman
here in America,
churches in America and outside of America, right, too, right now, yeah, in many countries, we cannot even being able to send these books out. Why? Because there is a church so powerful that even the kings or the government, the media, you know, different media, TV, radio, has been controlled by the popular church. And by God's grace, we'll still be able to do it from North America. So call, get involved into If you have understanding, if you understood this truth for the same time, you know, get involved into giving this message out. Also, we send my boxes, as you know, of this what we call the Earth Final Warning. You know, this is a newspaper type of material, easy to read, easy to distribute it. You know, the Earth Final Warning, liberty of conscience threatened. It's part of the study over here. It's a complete message for God's glory that we put together, easy to read again, so you out there, our listeners, can read it, understand the message that God has for the same time, just using the Bible and the Bible alone. Okay? We also have been publishing one of those pages in across America. We are trying to put it in Latin America, where this program is in Europe, you know, and, you know, we are not being so successful in those countries for the reason that I just gave. But like this one over here, the New York Times, the USA Today, you know, we've been putting out messages like this, the liberty of conscience threatened, you know. Can we see this taking place in North America too?
Yes.
Can we see this?
Yes.
My friends, yes. For the first time, not that long ago, in the Congress of the United States, the first time in the history of this nation, the Pope came and addressed the Congress. For many people, they might say, what is the importance of that? What is the big issue? Well, you know, why not calling, addressing the Congress, you know, people like us to bring this message out to them? I think they need to hear the message, yes. The message, or the 3 angels' message out, yeah. And so on and so on. Anyway, I don't want to take too much time on this because I just want you to keep praying for this program, for this ministry. Those of you who say that you understand and that you have accepted this message, you know who you are over there. Also, this booklet, What Happened After Death, free of charge. Pastor Barry, go ahead. You mentioned to me that you want to mention another book.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Another book that we want to show that can be made available to the public is the book called The Great Controversy, and this is the illustrated edition of The Great Controversy. Beautiful, beautiful illustrations throughout the volume. It's going to go into the history of destruction of Jerusalem. It's going to also go into the history of Christianity. Recently, the Protestant Reformation is supposed to have come to an end. Does the Bible teach that? And if so, what does it mean? Here we'll find that all this will be explained. The history of the early Christianity, history of the Protestant Reformation, the history of where we are now in the stream of time with things. We're going to see this and much more throughout this volume. It deals with past, present, and future events. And it's going to show us and it's going to help us understand the final events and how history will be repeated. It's going to also talk about America in prophecy. And the teachings of the sanctuary and the 2300 days found in the book of Daniel 8:14.
I'm sure you know, by God's grace, our ministry has been distributing, sending thousands and thousands of those books throughout the years to all of you out there who has been requesting the book. You know who you are. We have been sending the book free of charge. Now, obviously, this is a special edition.
Yes, yeah, it's a special edition that we want
to have to make arrangement with
make,
that.
Make arrangements for you with that.
Okay, right. How
but
to get it.
Beautiful illustrations all the way through, as you can see.
Right. Now, okay. Since you can speak more clearly
than
me.
And then we also join Gems of the Revelation. This is a beautiful volume that has beautiful compilations on how to study.
Made by Professor Jones.
Made by Professor Jones right here, compiled together. Beautiful, helping you to understand the book of Revelation, right. That there's a blessing pronounced on the study of the book of Revelation. It has historical
from
data.
From chapter 1 to chapter 22, brother.
That's right.
Verse by verse.
Wow.
With charts and illustrations.
So wait a minute. For those of you, even ministers, as you know, have said, well, those books, you know, it's not to be able to understood because there's so many symbols in there. Well, now the Lord is giving you the opportunity to understand every one of the symbols by calling and obtaining this book.
And we have this
and the book of Daniel, too.
And we have the book of Daniel. We don't
which
have
is around there someplace.
Right.
That, but that's okay.
But anyway, but we have the book of Daniel called that we need to...
Gems of Daniel.
Gems of Daniel and Gems of Revelation.
A compilation by Pastor John.
These volumes are not to take the place of the Bible, but it's only to help you and aid you in your study of the Bible. Mm-hmm. And this is a very rich compilation of many different Bible scholars and authors who come together to give you understanding of the book of Revelation, showing that the book of Revelation can be understood and the symbols can be made plain.
And unlike most commentaries on the book of Revelation, this takes the position of studying the book historically, not putting it way in the past or way in the future, but from the time of John giving the prophecy to the time of Christ's second coming, each line of prophecy.
I know this took you a long time. You don't have to tell me. A lot of sacrificing to put together these two big volumes, one on Daniel, one of Revelation. And even though he took all this time of his life, now you can have it by placing a phone call in our ministry and we'll make it available to you. Okay? All right. So, and then the other material that I want to, you know, that you can obviously get a hold of. And it is our desire that each one of you, each one of our TV viewer, and I know in many countries, like in Europe, that have been watching this program, we have been getting even communication from Pakistan, from India, people, you know, contacting us, and they are inviting us to, they want to see how we can, you know, go and have meetings in those countries based on these presentations. Well, let's keep praying because God has a way. God is opening big doors, and those doors, no man, no Jezebel, no Ahab, are going to be able to close.
Speaking of that, just one other volume to show you. And this is our deluxe edition of Desire of Ages.
Oh, that's another great book.
Now, this is on the life of Jesus. The most encouraging book on the life of Christ ever written. Over 2 million copies there in print with this volume alone. But this is one that we would recommend too. But it was also one that you could enjoy reading on the life of Christ. Because yes, we talk about prophecy. And yes, we talk about the things that are taking place around us. But there's one important element that we must all keep in mind. For us to possess the character of Christ, we need to understand his life. And this volume goes into the beautiful history of the life of Christ. It's beautifully, it's well written, beautifully illustrated, and it's one we know you really enjoy.
Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to continue, of course, after these presentations of the Son of the Literature that we have. We must continue with the going, you know, through Revelation 14, and we're going to do so right back.
Paul and Jesus both predict that the Church of God becomes a force against God.
The radical faith that Jesus taught had become the official religion of the empire that murdered him.
The speed with which the early church tobogganed into apostasy will take your breath away.
Welcome back, Pastor Barry.
Yeah, I just want to show you that the 104,000 dealt with overcoming, because not only the 104,000, but everybody will be in heaven will be overcomers.
Amen.
They overcame through the blood of the Lamb, through the blood of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. The promise of the overcomer, though, in Revelation 2:7, he shall eat of the tree of life. In Revelation, somebody read Revelation 2:7.
Revelation 2:7.
Yes.
He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God.
Notice that the tree of life is in heaven. When the tree of life was created, it was on earth. But now, the Bible, somehow, we know that God has evidently transported the tree of life because of the fact it's going to be in heaven. And they're going to enter into the Revelation 22:14 says, blessed are they that do his commandments, so they may have a right to the tree of life and enter him through the gates of the city. Mm-hmm. So that we know that the tree of life is in the New Jerusalem. Isn't that right?
It must have happened before Noah's flood.
Yeah, before the flood, evidently, because we know there's no place there. But notice carefully. It goes on, Revelation 22:11 says, dealing with the overcomer. Can you read that before, Pastor?
22:11, mm-hmm. Revelation.
And you can do 22:17.
2:11 says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death.
Okay, notice, eat of the tree of life. Did not hurt by the second death. Let's go again. Revelation 2:17 and 2:26.
2:26, okay.
To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it.
This is what the people that receive overcome.
Uh-huh. 2:26 says, and he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations.
Revelation 3:5 and Revelation 3:12.
Well, it continues, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers.
Okay. Revelation 3:5, Revelation 3:12.
3:5, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels.
So everyone that's going to be in heaven will have been overcomers,
amen.
And Jesus will confess their name before his Father and before holy angels. Amen. The last one, Revelation 3:21.
3:21, it says, to him that overcometh, will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and I am set down with my Father in his throne.
Now, this promise is very important, because notice something, that the 144,000 are where? Now, they're a great multitude, and they're out there, but the 144,000 are sitting with Christ in the throne.
In the throne of Christ.
Okay. And the great multitude is standing on the outside looking, and the 144,000 looking out at the great multitude, because they're the last generation. And the last generation will go through a time of trouble such as never was without an intercessor. Jesus never had an intercessor. When he was tempted by the devil in the wilderness, if Jesus had sinned, who would have interceded for him? Jesus had no intercessor. In the remaining of time, God will demonstrate that mankind can be trusted, and that mankind, through the victory in Christ Jesus, can be saved, and they will not need an intercessor anymore.
Amen.
They will stop sin.
They will be saved to be saved.
That's right. Safe to save. We'll put it that way for you. That's right. That's right. So it's very important that we understand. That's why we're looking at this issue of the 144,000 very carefully, because that group is going to sing the song of Moses and the Lamb. Moses and them sung the song after Pharaoh's armies drowned in the Red Sea. Do y'all remember what that song was? In Revelation, I think it's in Exodus 15. What was the song of Moses that they sung?
It's quite a lengthy song.
Yeah, but in Exodus chapter 15. Let's look at this song. It's one of them.
Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him an habitation. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name.
Then he goes on and said, Pharaoh's chariots and his horses have he cast into the sea. His chosen captains have he drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them, and they sank into the bottom as a stone. Thy right hand, O Lord, has become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, has dashed in pieces the enemies. And in the greatness of thy excellency, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee, and has sent forth thy wrath, which consumeth them as the stubble. and with the blast of thy nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The floods stood upright as a heap, and the depths were congealed in the heart of the sea. In the heart of the sea. Then it says, the enemy said, I have pursued, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil. My lust shall be satisfied upon them, and I will draw my sword. My hand shall destroy them. Thou didst blow with thy wind. The sea covered them, and they sank as a lead in the mighty waters. Who is like unto thee, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like unto thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? Thou stretchest out thy hand, the earth swallowed them. And thou in mercy hast led forth the people which thou hast redeemed. Thou hast guided them in thy strength unto thy holy habitation.
I was going to say, Moses and his people, they sang a song after they saw the destruction of the king and all his army. Do you know, I just Pharaoh. Want you to see the parallel. There's a parallel. In the end time too, after the 144,000 with the rising death in Christ will be taken to heaven. Wow. Look at this, around that time. Look what happened to the kings of this earth and to the beast and to the Revelation 17. You want to read it?
Revelation 17 what?
17 verse, I just had it over here. I said, wow, how God bring to us figures, symbols, you know, of the things in greater scale that's going to happen in this end time. Revelation 17, verse 16. Read it, please.
And the ten horns?
Right, yeah, read it.
And the ten horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. For God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will.
And on chapter 19 of Revelation, verses 17 and on, read it, please.
And I saw an angel standing in the sun. And he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God, that ye may eat the flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gather together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army.
And verse 20?
And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast, and then that had worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone.
Which is the second death, the Bible said, right?
Yes.
Another part of the Bible. Now, do you see the parallel? Why that son of the 144,000 is going to be so unique? It's because they were living in this earth during the time where the beast, the king of this earth, the whole world, actually, is going to be turning against them and will try to make them to go against God's commandment. But they remain so faithful. That's why in Revelation 14, it says that they followed the Christ in the Lamb for whosoever he went. That's the experience of the 144,000. The 144,000, and that was the experience of Moses with his people when they flee, when they came out of Egypt. It's parallel after parallel we find in the Bible. What else? Yes.
Could I read a verse about the 144,000? They're standing on Mount Zion, and they're singing the song, but that wasn't the first time they're singing, because in Isaiah 51, in verse 11, it says, therefore, the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing where? Unto Zion. And everlasting joy shall be upon their head, and they shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and mourning shall flee away. So the 144,000 are singing along the way to Zion.
Amen.
Now, my question to you is, now, when the Bible said they sung with harps and harps, why does the Bible mention harps and harping? You know, that was right there in verse 2 or 3, I think it was.
Right, right.
First of all, as you brought out Revelation 15:2, Where does the Bible mention? I saw it as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire. And then they got into victory, here you go, over the beast. What is victory? They got victory over sin, but that's a victory over the beast, over his image, over a mark, and over the number of his name. Stand upon the sea of glass, having the what? Harps of God. Hmm. Now, who were these people that stood on the sea of glass, having the harps of God? Having harps? He says, I heard number was sealed, and there was sealed 144,000 of all the tribes and children of Israel. They are before the throne and serve him day and night in his temple. Mm-hmm. We're going to find that 104,000 was the one that had the harps of God. Mm-hmm. But not only would 104,000 have harps, all the redeemed will have a harp. Mm-hmm. All right? We make that clear too. But then it goes on and says something else. What is the purpose of them singing now? Mm-hmm. You know, because they're going to sing before the throne. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Before the throne. Now, Revelation chapter 7, can you read for me, Patrick, Revelation 7, 15. Who's at the throne? Listen carefully at this.
Revelation 7:15. Mm-hmm. Therefore, are they before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple.
Now, this is the 144,000 before the throne of God, meaning in his temple. Mm-hmm. All right? All right, go on.
And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them.
Now, some people say, now, this is not the 144,000. This is the great multitude. No, this is the 104,000. How do we know? Look what it says. They shall what?
Hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them.
Now, why does the Bible say neither the sun light on them on any heat? Because this is the point that shows us why that we know this is the 144,000, not the great multitude that no man can number.
Because in Revelation 16,
in
verse 8 and 9, it says, the fourth angel poured out his vial upon
the
sun.
This is the vial. This is the wrath of God being poured out.
And power was given unto him to scorch men with fire, and men were scorched with great heat, and blasphemed the name of God,
Brother,
which
Patrick,
has power over these plagues.
Why don't we do this? We will continue in the next program. We need to close the program for today, reminding you that God wants you to be a special child into his kingdom. May God bless you all.
Our Voice of the Eternal Gospel family thanks you for joining us. Generous contributors like you keep us broadcasting. Prayerfully consider supporting this ministry. Donations are tax deductible and can be sent to Voice of the Eternal Gospel, P.O. Box 15138, West Palm Beach, Florida 33416. Our phone number is 1-866-7th-DAY-2. That's 1-866-784-3292. And our web address is voiceoftheeternalgospel.com.
Find out what the critics are raving about. Top scholars and theologians from around the country come together to reveal the hidden history of the Book of Revelation. With powerful reenactments and incredible visual effects, this 95-minute masterpiece brings to life the Book of Revelation like never before. Revelation is no longer a mystery. Get your copy today.